Halo. Halo.
Tech certificate, if you just go through here, it's very easy.
Itu si Minar.
Dr. Farida. We cannot hear you. Why your name is Mijan? Please open Madam's Zoom. Or change the name.
My name is Mijan.
Because in YouTube it will show that Dr. Farida, then it will show Mijan. Please change Mijan.
Okay.
Full name you write, Associate Professor Dr. Farida, otherwise public. Dr. Joita, madam, also in. Check your camera. Sound.
Now, okay, sir.
Mijan.
You're right, Associate Professor. Okay, Dr. Farida, okay. Can you see?
Can you see me?
Yes, your head is cutting. Okay, now okay.
Well, I can see your head only.
No, you are live on YouTube now. We can see you in YouTube also.
Hello.
Hello. So if I'm PC is mute, unmute, you are mute. I cannot control it. I know. I cannot control. Keep control.
Good afternoon, Dr. Sandip.
Yes.
Dr. Farida. Can you hear me?
Yes, yes, madam.
Oh, okay, thank you.
Yeah. Madam, very nice. You changed the background also.
Okay. Can you hear me?
Yes, yes, madam.
Okay, thank you.
Very nice, you change the background also.
Yeah, I change just like every day I change. just for the our flyer.
Madam, you open the YouTube somebody. Dr. Farida, you open YouTube.
No.
Echo coming?
No.
Assalamualaikum Dr. Farida.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi.
Iya, nice to meet you. Apa kabar?
Nah, bagaimana di Indonesia?
Baik, alhamdulillah. Indonesia baik. Kami ini di Bengkulu. So we are in Bengkulu city. This is the located in South Sumatra, in Sumatra Island. About 1 hour by flight from Jakarta.
Ah, the south. Near Jogja?
Not near. I mean from Jogja. So we have to transit in Jakarta first, and then continue our flight to Jogja. So from Bengkulu to Jakarta, and then Jogja. So have you visited? Have you been in Jogja?
Yes, I sent my student there.
Okay.
First training there.
Yeah. I passed my master in Jogja in Gajah Mada University. I graduated from there and I stayed there about 2 hours. Sorry, 2 years.
Yes.
Yeah, long time ago. Yeah.
No, okay. I went there in 2010.
You mean?
Yes.
Oh, okay.
There is a I was sent to the my teacher while I was in Jogja.
Oh, from KL?
I was there in Jogja. With the
okay.
There's a Devi, Devi something, I can't remember her name.
No, okay. Sorry, I couldn't hear you clearly, like that too far. This your voice is too far, sorry. I don't know what's problem with my laptop maybe, I don't know. Yeah, just...
No, madam's microphone is far.
That's why. Okay. I just worried about my laptop. Like yesterday, I got problem with my laptop. So that's why I just worried today. No. Okay.
Leon, madam's face cannot see. Dr. Farida, face cannot see.
Okay. Yeah, nice. Yeah, okay.
Not young, so no need to see.
Okay.
But you can see Dr. Polda's face.
Yes, my face.
Yeah.
If I off, I also can see.
Yeah. So we have already here Dr. Jayita. So in the morning in India right now, right?
No, it is.
Oh yeah, 2:30 p.m. Sorry, afternoon. Yeah, yeah. Okay. Yeah, I know. Okay.
Dr. Jayita, please unmute yourself and unmute the video on the video. Let me call her.
Yeah.
Another 15 minutes to do. Yesterday was 18. Okay, how to see the chat?
Yes, welcome, Dr. Jayita, madam. Dr. Unmute yourself.
Hello.
Yes.
Yes, I'm audible.
Yes, yes.
Thank you.
Good afternoon, Dr. Jaita. Nice to meet you.
Thank you. Good afternoon, ma'am.
Okay. How are you?
Okay, fine.
Okay, it's good. Okay. Yeah,
Dr.
thank you.
Jaita, listen to your talk also in BCKB last time in Kolkata, India, you would give talk.
Okay.
Jaita madam also listen to your talk that day.
Yes, I listened.
She knows you, but you're not seeing her.
Okay.
And Dr. Farida is our faculty member, Jaita Di. And Dr. Jaita was senior than me in research area. She also done research in cytogenetics.
Oh, nice. Okay. Yeah, so today we have the two great women for presenting this lecture today. It's really awesome.
Thank you, ma'am.
You're very welcome.
We have 10 minutes to start. Maybe more person will join in.
Yeah. So I don't know. There's still limited participants.
Only very few
joined.
Now.
Yeah. Because yesterday we have a lot of them, more than 100. And right now, yes. Maybe, yeah, just wait still maybe 10 more minutes.
Yesterday, total 260 participants was there.
Yes. Yeah.
Yesterday, 260.
Oh, very good. Very good topic yesterday.
More of
yeah. Yeah, this
really
good for women as
well. At home, I mean, acta sentence to bole dile reply korle bas mute.
Can see. Dr. Pada.
Yes.
So how are you?
I am very fine.
Okay.
Long time no see.
Oh.
Yeah. Are you in India or are you in Malaysia?
That is the confusion.
Yeah, I'm very confused.
Now I am traveling to India and Indonesia, in both.
Both you, one in Indonesia, one in Malaysia, one in Thailand,
one leg in Indonesia, one leg in India, and body in Malaysia.
She's back. Yeah. Hello, Dr. Pudya.
Radin, how are you?
Hi. I just come back from MPA.
Yes. Here, Datin is our Dean of Nursing Faculty and the Deputy Vice Chancellor also. Okay. Of University College.
Assalamualaikum. Yeah.
Madam Goswarni, Datin, Madam Goswarni is the Vice Rector of Pathpitula University. And also, she is the Associate Professor in Bengkulu University.
Assalamualaikum. Apa kabar, Bu? Sihat?
Waalaikumsalam, Din. Ya, Alhamdulillah sehat. Bagaimana kabar di Malaysia? Semua sehat ya?
Sehat semua, insya Allah.
Alhamdulillah. Ya.
Oke.
Okay. Saya Pak. Kebetulan nanti. Iya, gimana?
Oke. Okay. Terima kasih. Ya.
Oke. Okay.
Selamat ya, Bu.
Ya, terima kasih. Ya.
Permisi dulu ya.
Ya, silakan Ibu, silakan sukses ya. Yeah, so we have also some participant not only from Bengkulu. Now I see here from Kendari, from Sulawesi, Celebes Island, yeah, from the School of Medical Science as well.
Because I invite some of my students for this conference.
Pardon, Dr. Farida, can you say again?
Kandiri, from Kandiri, that's one of my students is there.
Oh, okay, good, thank you. Yeah. Yeah, we have also Dr. Sima Singh already joined, yeah, here. Good afternoon also, Dr. Sima, yeah. Yeah. at University of Bengkulu, we have the two faculties here. Let me just say this, the department. We have a School of Medical Science and also a faculty of Mathematics and Natural Science, but they organize for the Department of Nursing, Pharmacy, and also what they call midwifery. Yeah. So yesterday, a lot of students from nursing department joined. Hopefully today they will come again.
Inshallah, inshallah.
Inshallah. Yeah. How about in Malaysia, in Lincoln? How do you still, like in Indonesia, also here in Bengkulu, we conduct for online class. So until now, we still, like for defense, for a seminar, we also like buy online. This is it the same as in Lincoln?
Yes, we are doing online. Most of our own studies, I mean, on our lectures is on online.
Yeah.
Except that when they have to come for some practical, so we arrange for our lab session.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
But not every students have to come for the lab session.
Yeah. Same thing here also.
Yes.
Yeah, because from the government, from Ministry of Education, they have the, I mean, release the rule until December, we have to do for online class. Yeah.
Yes. Yes, our practical started, like dental lab, etc. started already.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And school also opened, half-half.
Yeah.
Half coming and half online.
Yeah, exactly same as here.
Half student.
Yeah, because it's difficult for students like the working in the lab, and also like my background, my major from forestry, they have to work in the forest and also like continue working in the lab by online. It's impossible. So that's why, yeah, we arrange for the shift. So it's not like make the crowd in the lab. So we, schedule for they come to work in the lab as well. Yeah.
I would like to share some of these students' experience with the online.
Mm-hmm.
So I did ask them. So most of the students said that, you know, they feel that it's good in once in a while, but somehow rather they miss that classroom environment.
Yeah. It's still, different because they need, like, you know, there's the body contact, there's, yeah, you know, like the something this our touching directly to the our class. So, yeah, it's happened to our student here. Most of them, they don't like the online class.
The lecturers also don't like online classes
exactly.
Because there is no classroom control. Very difficult to control.
Yeah. And also it's very expensive for internet as well here. So because most of our students come from the low economic as well, so that's why even though from government they give funding to help, but it's not enough, right? So that's why also big problem for the internet and also for the quality as well. Some areas they have the poor quality, so yeah, it's not good. Many times we have to stop for running the class because about this internet stop like that. So yeah,
we having the same problem as well in Malaysia.
Mm-hmm.
So because some of them halfway they have to stop because of the poor reception and they have to stop, not enough of those credit. So a lot of issues.
Yeah. And then for arrange for not all the class with Zoom, something like that. So most of our lecturer, they organize the class by WhatsApp. They just send a task by WhatsApp, and then like make the group in a WhatsApp group with students. So and then they told it's really good because for the some student, they don't, not active in the class, but in the WhatsApp chat. Yeah, many students also give comments, something like that. So Something's good by WhatsApp group.
Yeah, so everybody is busy with the phone.
Yeah, it's another our activity right now. every day from the morning until before gets sleep. So always handle this cell phone.
So I think this is a very good lesson for us. So we have to look at what will be our innovation in terms of doing online with all those practical sessions. They have to do something like the 3D, 4D, 6D or something like that, so that they can practice while they are at home. So when they come back, their skill is still there. You know, the competence, the skill is not missing. So currently, they complain that their skills, what they learned before, now slowly is fading away.
Okay. Yeah.
Maybe in short.
Yeah. Hopefully, this pandemic. I don't know. Maybe next year we will come back in the normal, like not new normal.
It's new normal. Yeah, normal and not new normal.
Yeah, it's real normal. Yeah. How about in India, Dr. Jayita? Is it the same thing? So while waiting for starting, maybe we can also discuss. Yeah.
Uh-huh. It's the same problem. Depending on the region where the college is located, the economic status of the students are varying.
Yeah.
So the colleges which are located in the cities, they can run online classes, but in the rural areas, what we are doing is uploading the videos and the lecture notes so that the students can access them according to their availability of the phone. Because many families are having only one phone. At some are getting access at night, some are getting access to it in the morning, and then the internet is also bandwidth is varying, so the connection is not uniform throughout the day. So these are the practical difficulties we are facing.
Yeah, it's many cases happen also in here.
Exactly.
I think around the world,
some problems are universal.
But no choice.
We have to evolve. Teachers are having to evolve first.
Yeah. But it's okay for for the college students, but for student in elementary school, it's really hard because many parents also complain because at home parents need to be a teacher.
Exactly.
And then for the kids, not kid study, but their parents study.
Exactly. And it is confusing for the students or the children also. We ask them not to play video games, don't stay glued to your screen. And then when it is coming to classes, we are saying that, yes, you should attend the class. So it's confusing for them also.
Oh my God. Yeah, hopefully. That's why I told. Next year, let's see. Pandemic is stopped, and then we can get back to normal life.
Exactly.
Your normal life. Yes.
New normal life. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Jayita, Dr. Farida, Dr. Sandeep.
Thank you.
Already.
Yes.
At four.
Actually, Dr. Emil also joined from Egypt. She is tomorrow's speaker.
Nice. Yeah.
Yesterday also she was there, but still she cannot connect with audio.
Okay.
But she is here already.
Yeah.
And Professor Dr. Prasoon also here, joined from Techno India Engineering Institute.
Yeah.
Dr. Prasoon.
Welcome back, to Professor Prasoon. Yeah.
I have seen her. And Professor Dr. Rewandi from Bengkulu also around.
Every day.
Hello. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yes.
How are you, Dr. Professor Rewandi?
Nice, nice to meet you.
Okay.
So,
thank you. Nice to meet you. Yeah, thank you. Alhamdulillah.
Thank you. So, we can start today's session.
Yeah, it's okay.
So, I just want to share one slide.
Yeah.
You can see my screen?
Yeah, it started, yeah. Okay. Not yet.
I think okay, no?
Not yet. Let me see. Yeah, has started. Okay, like now it's okay.
Okay, sorry. So today is the third day of international webinar on lifelong learning series. Welcome back, all of you, the participants and who have joined new today, and in YouTube also who is watching. Thank you for joining today, the third day, and we are doing this in collaboration with Lincoln University College, Malaysia, University of Bengkulu, Indonesia, and Techno India Engineering Institute of Technology India. And from Indonesia, University of Bengkulu, represented by Dr. Guswarani Madam, and Lincoln University College, I am here, and other participants also there. Today's speaker also from Lincoln University College, and Techno India Engineering, represented by Professor Dr. Prosoon Choudhury. She is also, Chakravarti, she is also around. And welcome back, all of the participants. And today we are going to our speakers. Our first speaker is Dr. Professor, Associate Professor Farida. Madam Farida is Associate Professor and many work experiences. She has worked as a clinical nursing director in Medina, Saudi, and head of nursing postgraduate and research in Lincoln University College, and head of nursing program in University Putra, Malaysia before. She has supervised many PhD students. Her niche area of interest include community and public health, nursing education.
Sorry, can you, change the slide and then make the slide so full screen so everyone can also read this your slide. For profile, Dr. Farida and as well. You have slide right there.
Yes, I make that.
Yeah, you can back to the first slide and then please make the full screen.
With the pull down.
Yes, yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, make please full screen, please.
Hanged, I think.
Oh, okay. Maybe just connection, internet connection. It's okay, no problem. Yeah, go ahead.
Coming half or full? Okay, I stop and.
I don't know what happened.
I don't know why it is like. It's coming half.
You half? I'm done. I think it's
okay. Now okay.
Yeah.
Okay, can see now?
Yeah, it's good. Yes. Perfect. Yeah, okay, thank you.
So sorry for the inconvenience. So Associate Professor Dr. Farida, as I told, she is working as head of nursing postgraduate and research in Lincoln University College. And she worked as head of nursing program in University Putra, Malaysia. She has supervised many PhD students, and her niche area is including community and public health nursing education. And her current research interest focus on smart e-health education, and she has awarded excellent outstanding quality award in Medina, Saudi, and she received 4 research grants when she serving University Putra, Malaysia. So as you can see her qualification, she has registered nurse, midwife, and public health nursing and PhD from University Putra Malaysia and Masters of Science from University Kebangsaan, National University of Malaysia. And now today she will speak on coping with mental health challenges with a new normal among women. So when she give among women, so she, I just give a comment that why not men? So she told, no, I will focus on women. And okay, madam. So the stage is yours, madam.
Thank you.
Thank you, madam.
And
please,
yeah,
share your slide.
Mental health.
Okay, can I start?
Yes, madam.
Okay, good evening everyone, and welcome back to the third day, and thank you for everybody for allow me and giving me the chance to share some of our experience in terms of coping with the mental challenges among the women during the okay, this is my outline. This is the content outline which I want to share today. There is about the 8 content outline there. But don't worry, I'm not going to make you more stressed because of the slides, right? Okay, I will go through the impact of coronavirus in the global society. And then we will just have a look into the emergence of mental health issues during the COVID-19, mental health challenges among women. We're also going to explore some of the determinants of psychosocial stressor during the COVID-19. We also going to look at and understand the grief process during COVID-19. And we are also going to have a look at the strategies of mental health services, and going to look at also what is the new normal which we're going to live for how long, still very unsure, and how to cope with the mental health challenges among the women. All right, so if you look at, okay, let me, it's very, okay. So if you look at my slide here, you see, as an introduction, you see how COVID has transformed the world significantly. For example, as shown in the slides, the picture of empty road. Before that, it was a very busy road in the USA. And in addition to the empty road, COVID-19 also has influenced and affected most individual in terms of their emotional. And they also having some excessive fear, anxiety, and anxious, which lead to the panic attack. All right?
Yeah.
Yeah, everybody is panic. So that's the reason why everybody start buying a lot of things. In US, they have a shortage of toilet paper. But however, everyone respond differently because of their background and because of their various in terms of their culture, all right? So we just have a brief overview of the impact of COVID-19 in the society. So the obvious transformation that COVID-19 had on the society is very, what do you call that, a mass death, isn't it? You can see that a lot of mortality and morbidity during the COVID-19. On top of that, they have also some socialization problems there. Before they used to work together, but now they have to work far apart. And if they used to do the visiting, so now they are forbidden to do all those visiting. And the worst thing is that what worries people most is the global economics downfall. So when you have a lot of business coming down, they will lead into unemployment. All right. So because of the unemployment, that will lead into the poverty. So there's no large gathering because of the poverty, and the education also stands still. From primary to secondary school to the university, all no education is going on. All of these will lead to mental health issues, all right? So now, having said that, you see how the environment, they said that during the COVID-19, because of not much of that physical activities, it improved the environment condition. I think everybody heard of that. You know, the environment become more cleaner, the forest become more healthier, the flower become more blooming, and everybody start doing gardening. And besides the environment, it also has some physical effect. And it also on the psychosocial aspect of human person. They become stressor, they become stressed, they become anxiety, become phobia, everything is all coming in subconsciously, right? So now if you look at some studies done during the COVID-19, they found that, you know, it is evidence-based that there are a lot of mental health issues during the COVID-19. If you look at this, result, you can see that almost 70% the young adults are complaining about their mental health. And of course, again, if you look at the ethnicity, this is from US, so the black have more concern. And interestingly, female are also much affected in their mental health, and those people from the middle income who has also been affected. I'm not sure the reason why, maybe you all can share the reason why the middle income are most affected compared to the rest. Because maybe because the lower income, they can get some, support, whereas in the higher incomes, they have they are not worried because they have a lot of saving. But those middle income, if they have lost their job, so they could be at risk of losing their job as well. So this slide shows that how pandemic causes spike in anxiety and depression. You see, compared to before in 2019, and in 2020, you see there is a lot of change, increase there. In 2019, it's only 8.2%, but in 2020, it's up, it's more than double, it's very high. Similarly with depression, you can see that almost 25% is complaining having symptoms of depression, and almost 34% also have anxiety and depressive disorder. You see how much people have been affected by the COVID-19. In terms of health and well-being of a human, of a society, you can see that most of those people are complaining about having problem in terms of staying asleep, or having problems to go to sleep, as well as poor appetite. Or some people who have different behavior when they are anxiety, when they are worried, they have more appetite, so they become overeating, all right? So in this slide, you can see that how much this COVID-19 has effect on impact on the job. So many people have lost their job, and this is the one of the reasons why they have some mental issues here. If you look at here, 54% who have lost their job complain of some issues with the mental health, right? So we can see from here how bad is that COVID-19 impact on the mental health besides the mortality and morbidity. Okay, this is another alarming indication of COVID-19. This is done by the psychiatric research where they found that the suicidal behavior is increased during COVID-19. So people like the reason of them commit suicide is that they feel that they will be impacting the children. There are some cases whereby they will lock in the airport and they cannot fly back to their own country. So they are in such a stress, so they wanted to commit suicide. I think this is a very alarming. This is not a good outcome from there. But if you look at this is more most worrying. This projection supported the previous research to say that people behavior in terms of suicide is increasing. And I guess from my personal opinion, this should not be seen very lightly. This people have to take up this projection because in near future, many people will start losing their job. So the suicide will be increased. So they need to have some sort of support services so that they can help people how to overcome this crisis in a better way. All right, having looking at all those overall impact on the society, now we want to see whether is there any difference between the women and men in terms of mental health during the COVID-19. What do you think about that? So if you look at this report, it shows that definitely women has higher mental stress compared to men. And regardless whether they have children or without children, they are very stressful on the coronavirus. All right. What are the reasons? This is a significant shares by the coronavirus and have negative impact on the mental health. You see, totally, it is absolutely female who have a higher mental health issues. See, compared to if you look at the major impact by male is only 15%, but for women is 24%, it's quite high. If a minor impact, also women have higher, better impact compared to men. So women always worry a lot, see? More women report feeling negative mental health effect. This is about the same, which you can see, if you can compare, women are always in a very stressful mindful. Okay, another area that we should concern is the in terms of abuse. Now, see, we have a lot of abuse report during the coronavirus. Okay, and the gender gap again. Mostly, the women are the ones who complain of that they've been abused by the abuser. The reason being, the reason of them to be high risk of being abused because of a few factors here, such as security, health, and money factors that increase them to be highly susceptible to abuse. Similarly, with the cramped living condition, of course, when you are sit together, the whole family in a small house, there is a lot of tension, stress, and anxiety happening in the house. So the risk of being abused is high there. Another, this is what a concern by many people is that the abuser and the victim are staying together. They have no way that they can go out because of the isolation. So they have a very high risk of being abused. And movement restriction, and as well as more of the deserted public space is also one of the few of the contributors. But the major concern is all about money, the cramp area, as well as being isolated with the abuser. Anyway, if you look at here, what is women is not mostly affected are the fertility rate. If you look at here, majority, all the countries shows that mostly men are more high susceptible on the fertility due to COVID compared to women. So they said that about 71% all cases that attributed to men, in contrast to only 25% being a woman. That means women are more safer. I think that is the reason why they worry about a lot, because of the how to look after all those people who are left behind. Maybe, probably, that is my assumption. So why this is the true assumption? My assumption is not accepted because medical experts said men are more susceptible to virus. Women have stronger immune response to virus. Genetic and hormonal difference may play a huge role in for a woman, as well as environmental factors could also contribute to the stronger immune system for a woman. Nevertheless, these reasons are debatable and researchable. So I'm sure that the men would not agree. That's the reason why I said, Dr. Poda, you don't have to join us. All right, okay. We move to the determinants of psychosocial stressor. Malaysian Ministry of Health is believe that in their guideline, they said that lack of factual information, rumors and fake news, and influenced by the social medias are the main cause of stressor among the public or among the society. So when they have all these not adequate information, the true information, and then adding to that with all those fake news, and then with all the social media showing all those unedited pictures, so they can cause stress among the society. All right. So if you look at the three main reasons just now, if you look at that and then you turn it into the framework, it will look like this. You know, how the COVID-19 influence on the mental health, which triggers on the anxiety, depression, and stress among the society, especially the woman. And what are the factors that triggers the mental health? You can see from the left and from the right. Again, it said lack of infection disease knowledge, lack of knowledge, and poor health behavior. And you have poor health, mental health yourself in terms of your self-judgment, your self-efficacy, in on top of the economic problem that will lead to your, because of your anxiety, you have changed in your sleeping pattern, which lead more to depression and stress, and you have some sleeping problem as well. So this is some of those factors that contribute to the anxiety, depression, and stress among society. Okay, if you look at this data again, it is written that women more likely than men to worry about negative consequences of coronavirus, except with regards to investment. So always men prefer to go for the investment, but women are always people think about their family. So they said that, if they asked them the question, they said, they are worried when if any members of the family will get sick, so women will women are the one who always worry most compared to men. So similarly, their saving is running low, so women worries more compared to men. So definitely, women has high risk of having mental health problems. Okay, in terms of looking at the contributing, let me check. I can see. So another contributing factors, again, this is about the economy. This is all about the same, the use of economy and with exposure to coronavirus and unable to go for the treatment and for the testing, always influence the woman mental health compared to the men. All right, so we already discussed more on the how much COVID-19 have impact on the women's mental health. So we want to look at how do people respond to this mental health, the process, the stages of that, the response, the anxiety, and so on. So I'm sure that everybody is quite aware on the Kubler-Ross stage of grief, because during COVID-19, everybody are grieving. Everybody experience grieving. According to Kubler-Ross, stages of grief offers an interpretation and series of possibilities by which situation involving traumatic loss. So in COVID-19, the loss is very unpredictable and very vast. Some people are grieving loss of their freedom, you know, because now because of the COVID, they cannot move around. They have to stay at home. So this is a grieving for them. And some of them grieving for the lost one, you know, the loved one who been infected or been affected by the COVID-19. And they also grieving for their predictable future. As early on for our discussion, we said that how long this COVID will last. Is it this year? Is it next year? Is it in 2 years time? We are not sure of our future. And they also not sure of their roles that they're going to continue. So this is all the grieving that they've gone through. So the grief involves fearful about work, health, families, the future in what they are unimaginable. Okay? And respond to this fear, anxiety, and depression varies. However, the stages of grief process are collectively reaction. Okay? So let us go for this Kubler-Ross stages of grieving. Everybody is aware that just for a recap, we have 5 stages of grieving. We have denial, anger, bargaining, depression, and acceptable. Think about ourselves. Do we go through this process when COVID-19 struck us? I'm sure that everybody has gone through the same process. So one of the things is that one of the signs of having this process is that disbelieving. You cannot accept. This is a resistance to the facts. So this is, I'm sure you heard some of those very famous from Donald Trump said that this is just like a normal flu. It will go by itself. You know, some people, this is what we call it at the denial stage. So when the anger stage, no, they are very, they start blaming why this coronavirus come in. So So the blaming is like what happened is that they say this, where do this coronavirus come from? So they start blaming the Chinese. They start blaming the Wuhan, who is spreading the virus. They start blaming all those people from China. They start blaming not only people from China. If you look at in other countries, they start blaming all the Chinese who they feel that they are related to this Wuhan. And the next stage is bargaining. So when they see that, you know, that's at a certain stage, you can see that this now they are making some bargaining there. Okay, when you have to be locked down. So when they have to be locked down, there is the bargaining stage take place. You know, they say, oh, if I were to go out, I would be infected. If my family go out, they will be infected. So this is all the bargaining start taking place. So this is a very critical issues here, because most of us, even though with the current situation, we said that I will show you in the next slide. People are still at the bargaining phase, even though we know that COVID-19 is a very serious issue here. So when they've been locked down, what happened to them? They become depressed, feeling of helplessness, hopelessness. This is where, at this stage, where they have really have to fight on this, what do you call that, the depression, mental health. So if you have a very good and strong, we'll call that mental health coping system, you should be able to overcome the depression. So the last phase is the acceptance. Now, some people, I did not say that most people, I said some people slowly try to accept the existence of COVID-19. So now you can see that most people start using the mask most of the time. So automatically, subconsciously, they will put on the mask when they see other people. So this is what we call that the acceptance. They keep on washing, they become obsessed with their hand hygiene, they're obsessed with everything. And they become obsessed with the cleanliness, in other words. So if they go out and when they come back, they start taking their bath or those things. I'm sure we have a lot of videos on that, right? So that is all the five stages of grieving. So this is what I said in terms of, if you look at the stages here, but this is, it is interpreted in a different way. So they said that almost everybody have the acceptance, they have not accepted 100%, but they are always in the bargaining phase. So that is the reason why we have to stress on the new normal, because when we are at the bargaining phase, we tend to have the COVID-19 flare up again. So we have to make sure that everybody really have to accept that COVID-19 is a new normal now. Okay, coping with these, coping with the strategies of mental health, all right? Outcome of COVID-19 varies among society. Some are positive, some are negative. Positive in terms of everybody now will be online. Even the old ladies who before that is not familiar with online, now they know how to do shopping online as well. That is a very good positive outcome. And the negative outcome is that what you say is the mental health, how much people been affected in terms of feeling depressed, anxiety, not because of the COVID itself, but because of their economic impact. All right. So in Malaysia, how do they cope with this system? They have a guideline here. So in Malaysia, Ministry of Health, they use this, what do you call that, pyramid for mental health and psychosocial support in emergency as a guideline for the paramedical to, we call that, to handle with this mental health, all right? So basically, in the community base, we are much involved with the first level and the second level. So we sort of empower individual plus the healthcare system in terms of providing the support of that mental health. Okay, what is the MHPSS, Mental Health Psychosocial Support, is a local or outside support during and post-crisis. And the aim is to protect and promote psychosocial well-being as well as preventive or treat of mental disorder. MHPSS cover the social problem, emotional distress, common such as depression, stress, post-traumatic, and a major mental such as psychosocial disorder. Type of support, they give them some sort of health intervention. So health intervention, they have medication or any other intervention, medical intervention. And another, which is much likely on the first and the second level, as I mentioned earlier on, is more on the health education and the skills, right? So this is the guideline which provided by the NUH. They say that in terms of national level, they do the assessment and the plan of MHPSS needs, coordinate the resources, coordinate the mobilization team, and providing the training, collaborate with others, agency, and many others. So I just highlight some of those important areas. Okay, state level, plan and evaluate MHPSS needs, coordinate the MHPSS activities, determine the types of MHPSS service required, provide technical advice. So most of us are providing the technical advices as well as collaborate and coordinate other agencies with various levels. Right. So what is the purpose of that MHPSS is to overcome these issues. You can see that the people with the medication, they have less problem compared to those who need the service, which they cannot get that service because of the MCO, they call it movement control orders. So they cannot go to the area. Right. Okay, now we're going to do, we're going to look at what is a new normal. So new normal is something that normal, but it is something is new, right? What is new normal? So if you look at now, society has to adjust to the new normal now. For how long? We don't know yet. Is it going to be this year? Or is it going to be next year it will end? Nobody can give the correct or definite answer. Because to date, nowadays, no cure for most diseases caused by the virus. Example, like common cold, there's no vaccine for that. HIV, since 1980s, there's no vaccine. But what happened is that society has learned to adapt and live with them, right? But unlike HIV, COVID-19 is more contagious and infectious. And it's not really associated with certain lifestyle. You cannot say because of smoking, they can get COVID-19, no. If you say that they have a poor lifestyle, also it's not about the lifestyle. So we don't know what is the reason. If you just go out and then suddenly you come back, you are being infected by the COVID-19. So this is a very, very strange, very, what we call that, very challenging. So that's the level of adaptation and the changes to make in individual life is much, much higher. We have to have a very strong determination here. So this adaptation and changes are considered as our new normal. So we have to make ourselves adapt to the new normal. So what are the new normals here? If you look at here, what happened is that now everybody have to work at home, right? And at first everybody was happy because that they can be with their family. they have to, they don't have to rush for the office, and it was something that people are looking forward and they can be with the family. But at the end of it, you see, what happened is that when they are too long in the house, okay, you can see from the picture here, everybody is all in a despair. Everybody is cannot control. They want to be free. Remember we said that they are grieving for their freedom? They want to be free now, because the thing is that now most of the time they are at home. So this situation is very difficult, especially for women who are doing double job here. Not only double job, maybe triple job. They are looking after the children, they are looking after the husband, they are looking for the other families of the members of the family. So it is very stressful. So there, and we have to adopt with the new procedures in shopping. So like Malaysia, whenever you want to go for a, I'm sure everywhere you have to be a check on that, that you're, whether you are having fever or not. So another way is that in order for you not to use the manual entrance, you have to use the barcode. So unfortunately for those, become very stressful, because if they do not have any smartphone, so they are afraid of using the pen because it can cause infection. So they feel that they are more prone to be infected. So this is a lot of stressful area here. And they have to be mindful that they cannot go with their friends, a group of friends, in, I can say, because they, in order for them to go into the mall, they have to be scanned, they have to be individual. If they want to go into the shop, only one person is allowed. That is a limitation. Whatever what they want to do, that is a limitation. All right. So this is a very stressful new normal that they have to adapt. Similarly, they have to be very obsessive with their cleanliness. You see, they have to do a lot of hand hygiene. So every time when they touch something, they start to do the cleaning. The mother, especially the mother, will say, wash your hand. Everything you touch, wash your hands. So this is another new era. And then, you know, when you want to speak to anybody, they must be at distance. You have to keep your social distancing here. So whenever you want to go for your favorite saloon, there must be certain procedures that you have to follow. This is all the new era that we have to follow. The most touching and for this new area, in this new era, is that how COVID has transformed the grieving process. Now is that everybody, before that, when there is some death, there are always some support system to be used to give you some more support. But with the, because of the COVID, now we have to learn how to live with grieving alone, and the funeral is also in isolation. And another new era is that you can see that how people is uncertain of their future as well. So you can see that this is all the new era, new normal era that we have to apply, okay? And how are we going to cope with this? You see, if you look at the system now, so you need, we need to have a very strong program so that this mental health can be tackled in a very systematic and a good way. So for the stakeholder, they have to strengthen the mental health service and program. For the healthcare personnel or healthcare system, they have to empower all the healthcare workers in not only in the hospital, but as well as in the community-based agency. For individual, they have to empower individuals, psychosocial and well-being, and to develop the skill. What I mean, now I'm just focusing more of that, what do you call that, individual psychosocial well-being and developing the skill. Okay. these are the strategies by the stakeholders, where they have a lot of policies that they have to deal. And this is by the healthcare system, whereby they have to empower all the staff in terms of the screening skills, where they have to detect any mood disorder, sign of depression, anxiety, and panic attack. And not forgetting to look for any sign of abuse. And they also need to have a very, very good referral system where they can do a referring appropriately. And they also have to have available, ready, a list of mental health providers, violent counselor, all those related to mental health. So they need to have that. For example, the number, the locations, the person, so that if anything happens, if anybody wants, they are able to get in contact with the counselor or whoever who can provide them with the mental health issues there. This is another skills that we have to learn, is about the very good listening. This listening skill is very difficult because everybody wants to talk compared to everybody wants to listen. So we have to have a listening skill, make time to talk to women about the specific concern or anxiety about the pandemic, and you must be ready with all the answer which is true without any duplication or any doubts on that information. And we encourage to have virtual, what do you call that, telemedicine, as what we are doing now, because this is the only way, the platform that you can go get close to your the customers or the patients. And for the empowering action is to give extended roles. What do you mean by extended role is that you give some of those health personnel who are not trained by as a counselor to have more of that their role in terms of providing counseling. So they need to have a proper training before they can do the counseling. So now I'm focusing more on individual coping system. So if you look at this framework and how we have two intervention here, there is interaction and action. So if you look at the interaction, when somebody is having some mental problems here, they need to go for the interaction. They need to have somebody that they can talk to, somebody that they can trust, so that they can ventilate, they can seek for any help. So you know, when you have a mental health, by talking is also sort of relieving their mental health problems. Okay, and developing life skills. You know, you need to have. This is what we said. Developing the skills in terms of coping mechanism. So we have to have a lot of program, as I mentioned earlier on. We need to have a lot of community-based program in teaching people how to do their coping mechanism and how to, what do you call that, having a good problem-solving technique and how to do their anger control. This is all doesn't come immediately. It need to go into a certain process, workshop, training, so that, you know, and counseling and guidance by the counselor. In terms of actions, they also can go into religious, they can have a positive thinking, social relationship, knowledge development, and so that by this, we can we hope that they can have a good mental health setting. Okay, this is one of the skills which developed during the COVID-19. If we can, I think think a majority people are sharing some, if you look at the video, YouTube, so many people are sharing some of their skills, which this is a very good part where you say that this is a positive outcome of that COVID-19, whereby they develop the skills in order to relieve or to release their tension and their worries, you see. So they can have the yoga, they can have yoga, they can have noodles, cooking, everything there. So lastly, I can say that, you know, they can, besides all those, they also can have, stay connected with their friends, maintain their healthy lifestyle, stay positive, stay informed, and definitely they need to have a support. So this is very, very good tips for them to. In conclusion, I can say that this all the tips for the positive mental health with COVID-19. This is all, you can get it all in the website. So they said, do a lot of positive thinking, regular exercise, balanced diet, relaxation, regular daily routine, socialization online. So they said socialization online, taking a break from the, but never take any abuse. Don't abuse your eating habit by eating so much, and do not have excessive online activity, and do not do any excessive watching television, because they say it's hard to use fake news to be there, and traveling is not allowed. So do not focus on negative aspect of COVID-19. But COVID-19 online is also not advisable, because you can see a lot of fake news on COVID-19 being transmitted through WhatsApp, which is very, it's not good, not healthy for the mental health. Yeah? And never believe in all the fake news. If you see any fake news, please confirm with the most trustable, authorized resources, rather than you just accept as what it is. Right? With that, we believe that, you know, the COVID-19 is the storm. So normally after the storm, it comes the rainbow. So hope for the better with that after the COVID-19. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Farida, for your nice presentation and covering all the aspects of mental health during COVID lockdown, and mainly on health aspect, we can tell. And of course, you give suggestions what to do for the all general people to how to call, keep safe. So there is some questions, but not related to what you call mental health. But it is question general that when we are expecting that economic situation will improve. So we can accept that economic situation will improve unless and until the COVID, we can keep it in our grip. Like in Malaysia, the case control, in cases in control, it is below 10, sometimes it is 0 per day, new cases reporting. And death is stopped from last 1 month. It is 125 fixed. So there is no more death. And ICU, there is no patients. So if controlled like that, then it is in our control. Like in last 100 years back, there is dengue or other epidemic, plague, etc. But we have controlled that. After that, we come back to our economic position. So accordingly, we can tell that after the economic position is okay, we can control the disease, we can come back. Next question is from Dr. Professor Gaurhari Shatra from Agriculture Science, Bhubaneswar, Orisha, India. He has asked, death due to COVID, survival of virus may be possible in dead body. If at all survive, how long? Yes, sir, the virus is surviving, but you know, after some death, after brain death declared, then only doctors issue the medical death certificate. So after death certificate, the body is going to be cremation or buried. So if it is cremated and buried, we are hopeful that the virus also cremated and buried accordingly. So next question, and if the body is in front, not buried or not cremated properly, then you understand not only COVID, there will other disease may spread due to the dead body. At last time, the plague dead bodies spreaded the disease. Now, next question is, I am from Nilesh Viana, that I am amazed by the coronavirus sufferer who has no symptoms, but has tested positive. Is there any similar cases? Yes. It is, of course, everywhere it is same. There is no such difference in different country. There are many patients without symptom, but tested positive. Yes. And there is also test with symptom, tested negative. So as yesterday, our Mr. Jogendra told, it is machine, and machine learns, machine learning is different. So machine giving the report. So it depends upon the machine and accuracy, and also that time the sample contain the virus, how much accordingly. So it is not that always positive means normal patient cannot come positive. It is, of course, there is symptomless patient also there. Next, final question from this session, Dr. Shima Singh, I think, yes, last final. Shima Singh asked, asymptomatic corona is not dangerous. Is it true? Yes, all same. It can spread the disease also. So,
and
thank you, Sandeep. Yes, madam.
From Ramya Krishna Koka, Resken, maybe we can also give the, chance for the raise hand to ask directly to Dr. Pandit.
Yes, yes. If anybody want to ask, can unmute and ask.
Ramya Krishna Koka. Yeah, I see here, raise hand, please.
You can, Ram Krishna Koka. Mm-hmm. You want to speak something? So you can unmute and ask.
Yeah, because
you're hello, ma'am. Asymptomatic conditions, how we can take care? Take care of that symptoms?
Which one?
Asymptomatic conditions, how the person should take care of themselves?
Oh, same, madam. If it is asymptomatic also, if tested positive, he has to keep him separated for minimum 14 days and again test. If come negative, then only go out and mix with other family members. Otherwise, stay isolated and maintain distance and keep safe others. Not spread the disease.
And keep on washing your hands.
Yes.
Mask. Put mask, even though at home, you have to put a mask.
The complete isolation also. Need.
Yes, complete isolation. So it's advisable if you go in the public to have more than 3 people, you have to put on a mask.
Okay, madam, there is no question in YouTube chat box. So
no, in YouTube, no. But another question come in chat Zoom. I mean, the new one. Let's see. From Dr. Sima Singh.
Already done.
Authentic test is a real time PCR or antibody test? Which one, this authentic test, is real time PCR or antibody test?
Which one?
And also another question come from Prophet Utpal Acharji. Is there any instance that that the same person who has tested positive again tested 2-3 times for confirmation? Maybe I don't know, maybe Dr. Farida, maybe you can also
answer some.
And then we can also continue to read the more question. Okay, please go ahead.
Yes. Mm-hmm. So there is instance for same persons who has tested positive, yes, again need to test for after after few days, 15 days, a quarter nine, again need to test. If it is negative, it is should be done 2-3 times, because one time it may not become positive as per laboratory rules. Okay, so I think we can go for our next speaker. We are running a little late, but almost all on time. Professor Prosoon also asked, can we frame a standard framework in context to prevention and treatment of COVID-19? we will ask this question at the valedictory session to you, sir. Thank you. And I thank you, Prof. Associate Professor Dr. Farida Muhammad Syed, our Madam Farida.
Yeah, thank you so much.
Thank you, Madam, for giving this nice lecture and spending your time at now Malaysia 6 p.m. already. You are still in office and doing this presentation.
Thank you. Yes. Thank you very much, Dr. Farida.
Thank you, Madam.
It's a really good lesson. Yeah, thank you.
Yes. So we are going for our next speaker. Dr. Joita, I just stop sharing your one. I share my one. Okay. Our next speaker is Dr. Joita Ghoshal. She is graduated from University of Calcutta with anthropology in his undergraduate level, with specialization in biological anthropology and human genetics in postgraduate or master's level. She was awarded national scholarship for her merit in both the graduate and postgraduate level, and she was awarded university grant commissions, junior research fellowship, and awarded her doctoral degree for her work on congenital malformations and syndromic disorders. Her works on cytogenetics, actually. Her main research interests include bioinformatics, reproductive behavior, human variation, and socioeconomic determinants of reproductive behavior and child care practices. She has served as faculty in Valli Charcha Kendra Vishwabharati University, Shantiniketan, West Bengal, and Mrinalini Datta Mahavidyapeeth, West Bengal, India. At present, she is associated with Narasinghe Datta College, Howrah, and as an assistant professor of anthropology. And she has also served as guest faculty in Department of Anthropology, University of Calcutta. And she has published number of papers, both in national and international journals, and presented in different national and international conferences. So she will speak today on women reproductive health care challenges during this pandemic, COVID pandemic time. So Dr. Joita, Madam, please. The stage is yours. And I also must tell that she is one of my senior research team member in our lab during my PhD studies. So thank you, Dr. Joita, Madam, for accepting the giving lecture. Now the stage is yours.
Thank you, Shundip. And I thank all the organizers for providing me a platform to share some of my views on women reproductive health care, the challenges that are being faced during this pandemic. Let us start with a quote of Maya Angelou that when women take care of their health, they become their best friend. Now, during this pandemic, COVID-19, what are the unique challenges, health challenges that women are facing? First, the 80% of healthcare workers are female. Then invisible illnesses like endometriosis and fibromyalgia are harder to manage because sometimes the symptoms are very difficult to assess, as the perception of symptoms in the women are not always understood properly. Pregnancy and family planning are harder to navigate, and in some cases, risk for domestic violence also goes up. Considering the gender-specific risks and challenges that women are facing during this pandemic, it is at three levels. One is at structural level, that is deprioritization of self-care and reproductive service. Now, what is structural level? That is the help and the facilities that are provided by the government, healthcare services to the women in general. And at social level, there is an increased fear of health services. Why? Since many hospitals and healthcare facilities are being turned into COVID hospitals or quarantine centers or isolation services, the general general facilities which are general facilities which are provided are not being not available, or people are afraid to go to these service points to get them checked or have the facilities. And at individual level, there is an increased risk of maternal mortality and morbidity. In spite of all this, a woman still needs contraception. The women who are infected with HIV, mainly in the sex industry sector, still needs HIV medication. The new mothers needs maternal care, postnatal care. All a girl from the adolescent stage still needs her supply of pads and tampons to take care of her monthly menstrual problems, and she still needs family planning resources, and most of all, she still needs protection from the virus. Now, if I clarify or classify the healthcare needs of women, it can be classified as the regular healthcare needs, the family planning methods, and for the mothers, it's either prenatal care, postnatal care, maternal care during postpartum period. For those suffering from infertility, they need assisted reproductive care, and reproductive health care needs of the migrant workers. Now, what are the wider impact COVID-19 has had on global health? Tuberculosis, HIV, malaria, these problems were present even before COVID-19 surfaced, but lack of proper medicinal facilities due to lockdown and other movement restrictions, there has been an additional 1.4 million deaths due to tuberculosis, another 673,000 HIV-related deaths, 382,000 malaria deaths. Now, if I consider the areas related with women, maternal and child health, there has been 2.3 million child deaths and 1,13,000 maternal deaths over the last 12 months. There, 80 million children are at risk of which could have been prevented if they had got the opportunity of routine immunization. Lack of routine immunization has put our child population of the world to another level of risk, which can be very difficult to combat if this lockdown continues and we are not able to control this pandemic. For non-communicable diseases like cancer, the treatment has been disrupted up to 40% in most countries. Uh, up to 50 million unwanted pregnancies will surface because lack of family planning methods are not available. Now, what are the factors affecting the use of essential health interventions during the COVID-19 pandemic? What are the supply of services during for health? Because a majority of the health facility capacity has been taken up by COVID-19 care. Then redeployment of morbidity, mortality of healthcare workers, because healthcare workers are mostly engaged in caring of the COVID-19 patients, both symptomatic and asymptomatic. And there is a, as I discussed in my previous slide, there has been a supply chain disruption regarding medications, regarding immunization, and availability of doctors. Now, why the demand for services has been disrupted? Because of movement restrictions. In many areas, there has been total, complete lockdown with no movement, especially in containment zones and in buffer zones, loss of employment, which has resulted in loss of income. So access to these healthcare services has been affected due to irregular supply of money. And last but not the least, there has been concerns about COVID-19 transmission. If a mother or a woman visits the healthcare facility, then as I discussed in my previous slide, at the individual level, there is always a fear of being transmitted with COVID. This is at the personal level, and this is the regular need of a woman, because it's a natural healthy process, and managing it with dignity and health is a ultimate need. In many, talking of India, in many states, when government has provided with facilities like grocery and all that, in some states, government has even provided their with the people with menstrual needs and family planning needs. Even many non-governmental organizations have also distributed these disposable pads or menstrual cups in the slum areas, and even in the areas or among the people whom they thought must need all these things. Because many women rely on commercially produced washable, reusable menstrual pads, but those without reliable products may need to innovate, because lack of income and lack of accessibility is really a problem. What are the reproductive healthcare needs which persist even during pandemic? It can be classified broadly into preventive services, gynecological cancer, abortion, pregnancy-related, contraception, and benign conditions. Now, what are the preventive services? Preventive services are sexually transmitted infections and HIV screening and counseling, which regularly takes place in women healthcare facilities. Then cervical cancer screening, HPV vaccination, breast cancer screening, IPV screening, and well human visits. In gynecological cancer, cervical cancer, ovarian cancer, uterine and vaginal precancers, and those affected are getting their screening and their management is getting disrupted due to disruption in health services. And pregnancy options like counseling by medication or procedural abortions are also getting affected. That is why there will be an increased number of unwanted births. And for benign conditions like endometriosis, fibroids, PCOS, which can be managed with medication, but due to lack of telemedicine facilities or access to doctor's advice, and also fear of being affected if they visit the doctors in the hospitals or primary health centers, these benign conditions are also getting neglected. Now, contraception facilities, which are carried out routinely in different health centers, consists of OCPs, patch, ring, IUDs, implants, injections, are also getting laid back. And the mothers and the women who have already entered into their pregnancy cycle, the prenatal and postpartum visits are not going according to the schedule. The labor and delivery procedures are getting affected. And as a result, if a pregnancy is detected with an ectopic pregnancy or an increased pregnancy loss has been in the rise also, because maternal mortality and morbidity, which I discussed earlier, is increasing. Now, till now I was talking about normal women, but women with disabilities and girls with disabilities also have some needs of their sexual and reproductive needs regularly. 29% of births by mothers with disabilities are not attended by a skilled health worker. Persons with disabilities are at higher risk of unwanted pregnancies and sexually transmitted infections. 20% of married women with disabilities have an unmet need for family planning. In France, an emerging data shows that during outbreak of COVID-19, the domestic violence has also increased, which has also resulted in various other mental problems for women. According to Global Status Report of UN, 923 million women of reproductive age want to avoid pregnancy due to many reasons, out of which 218 million of them have unmet unmet need for modern contraception. Now, if we look at this graph, in the past 3 months, a survey was taken where it was trying to assess whether many women have postponed care due to COVID-19 outbreak or most plan to seek care in upcoming months. 54% of the respondents have said that they have postponed or skipped medical care because of the coronavirus outbreak. And what was the result of the postponing or skipping of the medical care? In 12% of cases, the medical condition got worse. However, 41% said that it did not get worse. It was same as before. And when it was asked that whether the respondents will go to the health, seek care or help for the condition, they said 37% of the respondents said maybe in next 1 or 3 months they will go, but 1% said, responded that they will not go to any healthcare facilities. The problem is the economic condition of the worldwide population is not same or same. If we classify our world population into three major groups, that is low income countries, lower middle income countries, and upper middle income countries, it is apparent that when examining the proportion of women who deliver their babies in health facility, 97% of upper middle income countries deliver their child in healthcare facilities, whereas in low income countries, only 59% deliver in healthcare facilities. That means the rest of the children are born in their home, maybe with guided midwife or without the guidance of a midwife. Now, when in developing regions, there are about the 214 million women who want to prevent pregnancy, but not using modern contraception, they are 671 are using modern method, the 59% are using unmet method, and 155 are using the no methods at all. So this situation, as it will still persist, this will ultimately put a pressure on the world population belt. Now, for the people who are undergoing infertility treatment, it is advised that they must avoid starting new infertility treatment unless it's an emergency, delay embryo transfer when possible, talk to the providers by either video conferencing or telephone, or make a plan with the physician if you are already in mid-treatment style. Now, what happens for the women who are already pregnant? Pregnant women may be at increased risk for severe illness from COVID-19 compared with non-pregnant women. Pregnant women and their families should take steps to stay healthy and reduce their risk for getting COVID-19. So not only the mothers, the newborn child is also facing a further risk of getting infected by the virus. So it will be very difficult situation in such cases if the newborn gets infected with virus, but who has formulated a program and the steps which are to be taken during such types of instances. Now, keeping the newborn baby, as I discussed, is very important. The first thing, as my previous speaker has also said, wash your hands. Washing of hands is very important. Limiting contact with others is important to provide protective immunity by having proper food and by taking care of oneself. But we may use a mask, but a mask should never be used for a baby. Now, as I was talking of maternal morbidity, this is the general average time when maternal deaths occur. During this last, this is the survey taken during the last 12 months, what has happened during an additional indirect deaths due to COVID-19 in India, Indonesia, Nigeria, and Pakistan. An additional 31,980 of almost 32,000 maternal deaths have occurred. Another 4 lakh of neonatal deaths, and another 3 lakh of stillbirths have taken place due to improper management and lack of healthcare facilities, counseling by doctors, and proper checkup of the pregnant mothers. The last thing the healthcare system is facing is what about the migrant women workforce who leave their homes to work outside their places to other states or areas. So they are not registered with the government or institutional level facilities in their home and also in their work areas. So that puts an additional pressure when they go to meet their health needs. These are some of the pictures. The migrant women workforce, we can obviously see what they have gone through during this entire lockdown period. Now, what impacts the healthcare system has undergone or faced during this COVID-19 pandemic and the lockdown? There is an increased risk for frontline health workforce, gender imbalances, and representation across healthcare workforce has led to inequity, reduced access to vital health services, and exclusion from potential COVID-19 treatments. And there are several reproductive health services which may be deemed as unessential and be diverted due to COVID-19. We understand that women provide essential care in times of crisis, but their sexual and reproductive health needs are essential too. If we consider this graph in terms of physicians, the percentage of male and female in the African region, America, Mediterranean region, European region, Southeastern region, Western Pacific region, we see the males are outnumbering females in the areas of physicians. But when it comes to healthcare, that is the nursing facility, the percentage of female is much more. It is more than 50%. They're more than 75% in most cases. So these frontline health workers are maximum facing the crisis or the pressure the COVID-19 pandemic has exerted on them. Talking of new normal, the healthcare system has also gone a transition. The old healthcare system generally consisted of primary care, obstetrics and gynecology, endocrinology, cardiology, gastroenterology, etc. But after the pandemic, with the onset of pandemic, I must say, the new healthcare system is totally depending on women, and the veterans, etc., and healthish men. But most pressure is now on the women regarding their domestic care, looking after children, looking after the household, looking after their economic resources, managing household income, and those working women has an extra burden of meeting their goals and needs of their work they are associated with. Now the how does the healthcare system now looks like? Maximum is from informal services. What are informal services? Self-care, informal community care that we often discuss with our friends, with our peer groups, over phone, over WhatsApp, and other social media, and pharmacy-based services, because in some areas, people still rely on over-the-counter medication to get instant relief from some of the problems, health problems they are facing now. And obviously, since with COVID-19 pandemic, since most of the workforce is associated with this type of taking care of COVID, simple headaches and other related ailments people are depending for over-the-counter medications. And after that, if these three systems, services, fail to fulfill the needs of the people, then people are going to primary care and community services, then to district hospitals, and then to long stay facilities and specialist services. But everything is not so bleak. During the COVID-19 pandemic, where possible, many pregnancy-related services could be delivered via telemedicine. They can be classified into three types, that are services delivered during pregnancy. So what are the services delivered during pregnancy? That is during the prenatal care, lactation support, virtual postpartum visits, and services delivered during pregnancy, that is prenatal care, at-home monitoring of weight, blood pressure, fetal heart rate, blood sugar, etc. Consultation with specialists like maternal fetal medicine, genetic counselors, and virtual prenatal care visits. And what are the services delivered after pregnancy? That is during postpartum care, lactation support, and virtual postpartum visits. And services delivered during and after pregnancy, that is both prenatal and postnatal, are mental health care and online communication with providers. Ensuring sexual and reproductive health must be an integral part of the government's immediate response strategy. It could cause immeasurable damage to the progress that India has made in meeting the sustained development goal of gender equality. Reproductive rights are inalienable and have legitimate demands on public resources, even during and especially during a crisis. Talking of Dr. Alvaro Barmejo, Director General of International Planned Parenthood, women and girls are facing a lack of time, lack of choice, and lack of access to essential sexual and reproductive health services. If these losses can't be course corrected, then consequences will be catastrophic for women and girls, resulting in loss of health, autonomy, and life. Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Dr. Joyita Ghosa. And it is very, we can tell, it is very nice, lecture, and it is very informative as well, covering all the aspects. As we are talking with Dr. Goswami Madam and I, we are discussing that, yes, this is excellent presentation.
Yes.
Covering all the aspects,
yes,
of women life in COVID time, during lockdown. So even the disabled person and the pregnant and non-pregnant, all you covered nicely. Mm-hmm. So there is one or two questions in the chat box, like Mr. Simoe Bera asking that if mother has been affected by COVID, so should she feed breast milk to her baby? Is it safe? Or will it increase the chance for baby also to get affected by COVID?
So, according to the breastfeeding network, World Breastfeeding Network, breastfeeding a child during if a mother is infected is safe. Even a HIV infected mother can also feed, because the colostrum is the primary source of source which can prevent a baby from getting proper immunization. And if we feed a child from outside food, outside supplement, that can be also a additional source of infection, because it will involve a bottle, multiple layers of source of infection, either a bottle or a spoon, whatever it is. So the more we minimize the layers of contact, the chance of getting cross infection will become less, because for breastfeeding, for outside breastfeeding, then cross infection from water and other related other cross infections might also take place. So we have to take care of that also.
Yes. So Dr. Farida also asked the same. But if the mother is affected, highly affected with coughing, etc., so that time
it should
keep separate. If it is not affected, baby is not affected, we should keep separate isolation.
Separate isolation.
So this is the question. Next is, are coronavirus survived in dead body? This one already asked already by Professor Gourhori. We already answered. Okay, I think no more. And yes, next is Mariam Lugu asking what things to do when a woman having COVID while she is pregnant, or the risk must be so high. What's better way to prevent the risk that will be happened? So,
can you repeat?
Miss Mariam, can you ask the question? You can unmute and ask. Means what are the risk of women having COVID while
okay,
she is
hello,
pregnant?
Dr. Jayita.
Okay, go ahead. Please ask to the doctor.
Hello, Dr. Jayita, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
Okay, my question is about a pregnant woman who is having COVID-19, I mean, the risk must be so high. So what's the better way to prevent, to avoid the high risk level of all things that are going to be happening? Because while having COVID-19, it's going to be so hard, but she needs to, like, holding it, but she's pregnant. So what's the better way to prevent that?
In that case, a primary caregiver must be with her, because handling a pregnancy and isolation all by herself will be a little difficult. So on proper health care, proper health care and counseling, this thing must be taken care of.
Thank you, Ms.
Okay.
Mariam, for asking the question. So if there are no other questions, Madam Gushwani.
I think another question, right? In the chat, maybe. Let's see. Yeah, I read.
No, already discussed, Madam.
Okay. Already? Okay.
We have given the feedback link in the YouTube and in Zoom also. So kindly fill that. And
yeah, please everyone again, to fill here. Yeah.
With the same link tomorrow, the same time.
Yes, exactly. And also for everyone who watching us on YouTube, please complete the form. And then we will send the certificate to your email later. And please don't forget to join us in the same time and also in the same, what's it called? The same room, Zoom. Yeah.
Thank you. Both the speakers, I think Dr. Farida also still around, but she may be now traveling, but she is on, I think. And Dr. Jayita also, thank you. And So anyone you can fill, Dr. Mr. Prabhat Utpal, anyone, same link, just it is shortened form. Both link are same. Both the Google form link is same, just fill anyone, one single time. No issue. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Maybe we can also like the give a chance for one participant here to ask Dr. Jaita directly, maybe. Anyone to
yes, ask, anyone do any interaction?
Yeah. We still have maybe 2 more minutes, maybe. Anyone?
Yes, no problem. Anybody want to talk? Can unmute and talk?
No, maybe it's too late. Maybe it's okay. Thank you, Dr. Jaita, for this really nice sharing. It's based on your result and also from many what you call the coverage. Yeah, we also chat with. I chat with Dr. Poder, Sandy Poder, and yeah, we're really excited for this your presentation. Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you a lot.
It was my pleasure.
giving us, you know, like the enlighten this our knowledge about something about the women reproductive health. Yeah. And yeah, see you again for next lecture. Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
And thank also you. Thanks for everyone, Dr. Sandeep. Yeah, we yes. also have a participant from Pakistan. Yeah, Erit here from Pakistan, and of course from Egypt, and yeah, for sure from Indonesia, Malaysia, and India. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody, for joining, and stay safe. We will meet again tomorrow.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay, everyone. Thank you. Thank you so much, and have a good night. See you again for the tomorrow. Okay. Bye bye. See you.